be seated.
問題係邊位啊?
Who would take Mr. Wuchiwai's question? Yes? Let me give you some background information about BEPS, base erosion and profit shifting. It's proposed by the OECD. Hong Kong has undertaken to follow OECD's requirement in implementing four measures. Now, for the BEPS action plan under OECD, there is something called harmful tax practices. In short, harmful tax practice means that for the sake of protecting your economy, you harm other economies. That is to say, you only offer tax concessions to foreigners but not local residents. For example, you offer tax concessions to transactions carried out overseas but not to similar transactions carried out locally. In essence, you're attracting foreign investors to your economy, and you're attracting foreign transactions to take place in your economy. And you'll be receiving less from tax revenue, and that is called a harmful tax practice. The OECD, however, also understands that if there is substantive economic activities, say we are an international financial sector, we have a very substantial financial services industry, we also have a regional headquarters set up in Hong Kong, that means we have actual economic activities here comparing to other tax jurisdictions in the Caribbean, and that's the background. We are offering tax concessions for OFCs, that is to say, part of their profits are not chargeable to profit tax. So we need to meet the OECD's requirements. First of all, there should be some form of capital requirement on the companies. There should be a certain number of investors, and only licensed fund managers should be used, and they should also be subject to monitoring by the SFC. These measures are put in place to meet the OECD's requirements so that we won't be labeled as having harmful tax practices. Now, our consideration is this. At the moment, the OECD has not reviewed the situation regarding the fund industry. But I'd like to point out that the European Union is reviewing the matter in this regard. And the European Union, similarly, will look at whether the OFC enjoys tax exemption, whether it only applies to a foreign OFC. So for the OFC, it should be locally incorporated and supervised, and there is no issue of harmful tax practices. Second point, there is no limitation on the origin of investors. They can be locals, they can be foreigners, and there is no geographical restrictions on where the transactions should take place. Say for securities transaction, the securities could be local securities or foreign securities. So first of all, for the fund, it should be registered in and set up in Hong Kong, overseen by the SFC with actual economic activities. Second, investors, we welcome locals and foreigners. Third, transactions can be carried out locally or overseas. So we believe these few points should help us meet the OECD's requirements. The other point is this. We also have anti-tax evasion measures or tax avoidance measures. Say for transactions involving local immovable property, or transactions involving the trading of commodities outside the remit of the OFC, we have the provisions. And we believe those provisions can meet the OECD's requirements. As such, we don't think the enhancement measures proposed in the amendment bill will contravene the OECD or the EU's requirement. Any follow-up, Mr. Wu? Because there is limitation on the investment aspect, there is a so-called 10%. 10% not subject to any regulation, whereas for the remaining 90%, it must be invested in securities, if I understand correctly. That means the main business of the OFC is on stock investment. The portfolio, however, could be very extensive. And tax concession here refers to tax profits derived from investment in securities. And in the process, the necessary stamp duty payments will still have to be made. I just want to confirm this. Yes, Mr. Chu. Let me supplement. In short, the majority of profits should be tax exempted because for the designated transactions, meaning securities, they are exempted from tax. But let's say the company may also invest in a factory and the profits will be chargeable to profits tax. Let's say if the OFC invests in a publicly listed real estate company, then the profits derived would also be chargeable to profits tax. What we're referring to as tax concession is the part about a securities transaction. For stamp duty, there are actually two levels. Let's say if you trade in local stocks, you need to pay stamp duty. But you don't need to pay the profits tax for trading local stock. Now, for the other level, we're talking about the transfer of shares of the OFC. Like the PS mentioned, our approach will be consistent with that applied to unit trusts. Mr. James Toh, I'd like to follow up on paragraph 31. Regarding the government's responses to submissions. Can you read this? As the deeming provisions are only applicable to residents, the proposed regime may be considered to have a ring-fencing feature, and thus a harmful tax practice by the OECD. The deeming provisions are only applicable to residents, but does it also apply? Do they also apply to non-local residents? I think that's what their submission is about. Thank you for the question. Let me set out the basic principle. For any tax jurisdiction, in relation to the local immovable property, it applies. And for any tax jurisdiction, their income can be taxable. The local residents' income is taxable. Well, of course, immovable properties related to Hong Kong, tax residents, of course, related to Hong Kong. In short, Hong Kong retains the right to charge tax, and we don't consider it any harmful tax practices. The industry, of course, would like us to open up even more, but that's the practice that we will maintain at the moment. Are you suggesting that this is relevant to this provision? If the deeming provisions are applicable to non-residents, what does that mean? I mean, I'm not clear, but let's take it that, well, let's say I am putting this question. What would be the implication? In theory, do we have the jurisdiction to apply this to non-residents? In short, well, I'm referring to a non-resident, a non-Hong Kong tax resident. As far as taxation is concerned, we do not have tax jurisdiction over a non-Hong Kong tax resident. So to respond to Mr. To's question, let's say if I want to introduce a requirement to tax the non-Hong Kong tax resident, I think technically speaking, as far as the provisions are concerned, it would be very difficult. Then I find it even more peculiar for this person holding this viewpoint. Let's say I am the one expressing this view. I'd like you to be more open-minded. But the deeming provisions cannot apply to non-Hong Kong tax residents, according to your answer. Is that right? You only tax residents who have a presence in Hong Kong, so to speak. So if you can tax non-Hong Kong tax residents as well, then won't the situation be worse? Or is it the case that in some areas deductions will be allowed and the deductions would exceed the chargeable income? I don't think there's any mentioning of this point. It doesn't say that the deeming provisions, I think it is suggesting that the deeming provisions should be scrapped to make the whole system fairer. Can you explain, however, why for residents you have deeming provisions and why the deeming provisions do not apply to non-Hong Kong tax residents? First of all, I want to point out that Chairman's view is consistent with the IRD, and this is the right direction. Let me repeat the last point. Hong Kong at the moment have bilateral taxation arrangements with other jurisdictions. The major principle is that Hong Kong has no tax jurisdiction over non-Hong Kong tax residents unless there is an established authority set up in Hong Kong by the other jurisdiction, or unless it so happened that there is withholding tax on dividends of transactions carried out locally. And we do have tax jurisdiction enshrined in certain treaties over this matter. But you would also understand that we do not charge tax on dividends, and that's the presumption. For non-Hong Kong tax resident, under the agreement, unless they have an established authority, meaning an office set up in Hong Kong, there is no way we can charge tax. That is why the provisions actually carry no effect. We won't be able to tax those residents. And the industry's view is that, that we should also relax the requirement on residence.
You have explained your views to the committee, but I have one final question. Are you confident that his view would not contravene with the OECD? Can you confirm that? People or organizations who make their views will certainly lodge complaints or make their views known. And the OECD would take in views from different parties consistently. sometimes governments might take action on tax matters. So the OECD has laid out their principles. So we are only concerned whether what we are doing would comply with those principles. If you are very confident, I tend to agree with your drafting. However, I hope that we won't suddenly be deemed to be contravening. That would not be ideal. Deputy Commissioner, thank you very much for the reminder. On a technical level, the EU has not examined our relevant provisions on OFCs, but the EU has looked at our legislation on offshore funds, and they did not raise any objections. Mr. To, you asked whether I am very confident. I can only say that so far I have confidence. But we must realize that Hong Kong does not set the rules. So if the rules are modified, well, I'm just talking about the existing rules. Well, let's say I am confident. Policies aside, what would how much losses would we suffer if we include the proposed coverage? Mr. To asked if we give up on this, how much losses would be incurred. Open-ended funds are a new product, so it's hard to foresee the developments. Let's say if open-ended funds are very popular, tax revenue would be very high. So people would resort to these funds in order to avoid taxes. Any further questions, Mr. To? Any questions from other members on these two papers? If not, we can continue with the clause-by-clause examination. Last time, we stopped before 20 AI of the Blue Bill, and the government is moving some committee stage amendments. So apart from scrutinizing the Blue Bill, we would also scrutinize the committee stage amendments. So like last time, we would refer to the English text of the Blue Bill, starting from Section 20AI. As the chairman said, last time we scrutinized the bill up to the new Section 20AI. Like Mr. Sun suggested, we are moving some amendments. So we would like to go back to Section 20AG because we have an amendment on this section. So the amendment is in subsection 4 of 20AG that explains the segregation of liability for a subfund. Generally, any loss sustained by a subfund cannot offset the assessable profits of another subfund of the same main company. In the bill, we would remove the 10% de minimis rule. So in 20AG subsection 4, Descriptions on tax-exempted transactions under the de minimis rule could be removed. So the words "any losses sustained by someone from a transaction referred to in Section 20AHA would be removed. So in Section 20AH 1, 2, 4, and 9, there would be amendments. Section 20AH prescribes that certain profits of certain OFCs can be exempted from payment of tax. In our amendments for an open-ended fund company, apart from non-qualified transactions, the transactions could be exempted from tax. So we would add a section C that non-qualifying transactions would be exempted, and there would be provisions on the de minimis rule. As for the specified transactions which would not be tax exempted, they are in the new subsection 4A and subsection 4. If an OFC invests in a private company, and if the private company holds immovable properties in Hong Kong directly or indirectly, if the property exceeds 10% of the asset of the private company, the OFC must pay taxes on the transactions. So 4A prevents some speculation activities of OFCs by making use of private companies. So in 4B, if an OFC invests in a private company, and if the OFC holds ownership of that private company, if at least half the assets of the private company are short-term assets of less than 3 years, the OFC would have to pay taxes based on 4B. This would prevent the speculation of short-term assets or commodities through OFCs. For 4C, is there any definition on short-term assets? The definitions are in subsection 9. So short-term assets are non-Schedule 16A classes, and the holding period would be less than 3 years, and it does not include immovable property in Hong Kong. Any other questions? Please continue. As we explained, we hope that parties would not engage in trade activities through OFC. So under 4C, if an OFC engages in non-Schedule 16A class activities, those activities would be taxable. As the government has explained, if an OFC needs to pay taxes according to subsection 4A, B, or C, it would not affect the tax exemptions enjoyed by other parts of the OFCs, and this is the no tainting rule. So for the short-term assets, we have prescribed a definition. Next, Section 20AI. Twenty AI is about the meaning of non-closely held. Subsection 1 stipulates that the section applies to the interpretation of Section 20H. In other words, 20 AI prescribes how the OFCs can comply with the non-closely held condition. And in subsection 2, an open-ended fund company is non-closely held if the following conditions are met in good faith. And there are three conditions. First, the NCH condition. Two, the investment condition. And three, about the provisions. In 20AH subsection 2, it explains that with or without qualified investors, the conditions that must be met by the OFCs. Sorry, I'd like to interrupt. Some members or legal advisor asked why the words in good faith must be inserted. If all these conditions 1, 2, 3, and 4 are satisfied, and that should be adequate. Why did you include the words in good faith? The question had been asked earlier, and the conditions are objective ones which could be easily assessed. So what is the meaning of the words in good faith? So are you going to disqualify those funds if they are not in good faith? And similar phrases such as bona fide are used in other parts of the Inland Revenue Ordinance, even though the minimum number of investors has been specified. But sometimes we would need to clarify the investors and nominees. That's why we have included the words in good faith, so that the IRD can assess taxes accordingly. Please continue. Regardless of whether they are qualified investors, and we will come to the definition of such in a moment. And funds must meet some requirements, including a minimum number of investors, and the funds must be non-closely held. For qualified investors, there are requirements on the investment values, because we want the OFCs to be of a specific scale. As for the rights of investors, a cap is imposed. Again, we hope that the funds would not be closely held. As for the relevant persons and the and their associates, there's an upper cap. As for the minimum or ceiling of the investments, they are in 16B. Apart from the ownership requirements, and in 12B and 12C, the OFCs are required to fulfill certain provisions or requirements. OFCs are required to indicate that they are non-closely held in their certificates of incorporation and the articles, and the OFC investors must not be prescribed persons or their associates.
Subsection 3,
the company is regarded as non-closely held, and this is a provision. In answering members' questions, we explained that after the fund has been set up, initially, the OFC may not be able to meet the requirements, and that is why we give a period of the maximum of 24 months to allow the OFC to meet the requirements in order to get tax exemption. As an anti-abuse measure, and also to having considered the operational needs of some fund companies in subsection 4, we provide that the OFC may not be regarded as a non-closely held if, in the opinion of the commissioner, the company has failed to take active steps to meet the requirement, and the main purpose, or one of the main purposes of such failure, is to avoid, postpone, or reduce the company's liability to tax. And also, if the company has indicated to the commissioner that the company would not want to be regarded as non-closely held, as mentioned just now. For the NCH conditions, they are set out in Schedule B, 16B. We have taken into account the fact that these conditions may change due to change in the local environment and the global environment. In subsection 5, therefore, we have empowered the Commissioner so that he may, by notice, publish in the Gazette Amendment Schedule 16B. And this will be done by way of negative vetting. For the definitions in Schedule 16B, you're copying the other instruments. For Schedule 16B, starting from 2014, we have conducted rounds of consultations. And we've also drawn reference to the average number of investors and the amount each investor might put in for an average fund. And this is the information from the industry. Subsection 6 sets out definitions applicable to 11 as well as Schedule 16B. We have a qualified. We have the definition for qualified investor, and we mentioned that in our answer to Mr. Ronick Chen. Basically, qualified investor means an institutional investor with investors investing in them. So, the number of investors required for a qualified investor comparing to a non-qualified investor will be fewer. The first group of qualified investor would be an institutional investor established and operated for religious, charitable, scientific, artistic, cultural, athletic, or educational purposes. Second, it is exempt from income tax. Basically, we have some collective investment schemes. And we also have we also have an entity providing retirement, disability, death benefits, etc. And we also like to include sovereign fund, because a government entity or sovereign fund also meets an institutional investor's definition. In the bill, however, we believe that we need to clarify the definition. In the amendment, we're going to add G to include a sovereign fund in the definition. In the definition of qualified investor, it says an institutional investor that meets all of the following conditions. And then from Roman number 1 to 5, all must be met. What about the pension fund? I don't see any mentioning of it. Pension fund. Pension fund should come under C, D, because C refers to schemes under the MPF schemes. And D, an entity established to provide retirement, disability, or death benefits. I want to go back to A. And institutional investor, that meets all of the following conditions. Will it be too stringent? You need to follow all the conditions in Roman numbers 1 to 5. A1, it's for religious, charitable, scientific purposes. Have you drawn reference from funds set up overseas, their legal status, their purposes, etc.? Because it seems to be a rather high threshold. Deputy Commissioner, thank you, Chairman, for your question. You asked whether we have drawn reference from other funds. The answer is yes. It's actually a definition coming from the OECD, and we then amended in the Hong Kong context. We're actually talking about charitable organizations. And how do we define charitable organizations? We define it by its purpose, and that it enjoys tax exemption in the jurisdiction. It has no shareholders or members who have a proprietary interest. And if fees are charged, the fees should be pegged to the charitable services provided by the organization. In terms of the automatic exchange of information on tax matters, we do have a similar provision. Please continue, Ma'am Chang. 28J now. Supplementary provisions for Section 20AH. Having considered the operational needs of OFCs, we provide a safe harbor rules. The first one provides that if the NCH conditions is not met in respect of an open-ended fund company, OFC, the commissioner may, on application by the company, nevertheless regard the conditions have been met in respect of the company if, say, the Commission is satisfied that the failure is due to the winding down of the company's activities and investment. We're talking about a fund company. The fund may operate for some time and then go through a winding down process. Second scenario, whether the failure is due to unforeseen circumstances so that the company could not meet the NCH conditions. And the commissioner would consider the nature of the unforeseeable circumstances, the period it lasts, and whether the company itself has taken remedial actions to address the failure. Subsection 2, it relates to the safe harbor rules in relation to the 10% de minimis limit. As we are going to scrap the 10% de minimis rule, we are also going to scrap this safe harbor rule in subsection 2. Subsection 4, likewise, it also refers to the same 10% de minimis limit, so it will be scrapped. So subsections 2 and 4 will be repealed, and it's technical in nature. Do you have a question, legal advisor? 20AJ1B. 2, the failure is temporary. How do you gauge whether it's temporary? Who would take the question? Deputy Commissioner. Thank you, Chairman. The failure is temporary. Of course, it's relative in time comparing to the failure being permanent. And we need to retain flexibility in drafting this provision. Or else, it would be very easy for the industry to not meet this requirement. The condition is that if the failure is temporary, then the commissioner can consider this factor along with other factors and still consider the condition as being met. As to what is meant by temporary, let me give you an example. Let's say if there is another financial tsunami, the temporary situation might last longer. Whereas in other circumstances, the OFC may be holding a position an investment position for a short period of time, and this period of so-called temporary failure might actually be shorter. So as a matter of fact, please continue, Madam Chair. 28J subsection 3. Well, we discussed the arrangement regarding profit tax if a fund manager received dividends from the company. If the OFC in relation to tax dividends received from the company, it is possible that the dividends received may be chargeable to profits tax. So the consideration or remuneration received by the fund manager may also be exempt from tax, but this is not in line with our principle, because for income or profits derived from the professional services provided, according to the Deputy Commissioner's explanation, the income or profits should be chargeable to tax. And we clarified the situation in subsection 3. Subsection 4, or 28K, accessible profits of open-ended fund companies regarded as accessible profits of resident person. This is the deeming provision. We explained the necessity of this deeming provision. If a resident person has during any period of time a beneficial interest, whether direct or indirect or both, in an OFC, then would be deemed to have accessible profits. And the requirement is set out in subsection 2, and that is interest in not less than 30% of the issued share capital of the company. If the company is an associate of the resident person, then even if the beneficial interest does not exceed 30% of the issued share capital of the company, it will still be regarded as having generated accessible profit. Subsection 4 clarifies the matter. Whether a resident has received directly or indirectly from the OFC any money or any property, it will be regarded as profits of the company for the year of assessment. And that's the details of the deeming provisions. For 28K, I want to clarify. If it meets the NCH condition, I wonder if it's a common practice to have provisions similar to 28K. And is it the case that the IRD will take the initiative in assessing the tax resident, or will the tax resident be required to report to the IRD on its own initiative?
I'd like to explain the deeming provision or round-tripping. For non-closely held, the persons can be connected, for example, father and son, parent company and subsidiary. But for the round-trip condition, for associates, they would be considered as one. Um, the round tripping condition is necessary because the NCH condition is rather lax, so we need another provision here. How would you make the assessment? Would you require the taxpayers to make declarations? There are two functions. One, this is an anti-tax avoidance provision. The ILD will look at the specific cases to see whether taxes need to be assessed. The for the tax returns, currently there is a box for residents to declare whether they have assessable profits of OFCs. Local tax residents have made such declarations and paid profits taxes. Ms. Chang, please continue. In 28K subsection 5, it prescribes the extent of a resident person's beneficial interest in an OFC, which is determined in accordance with Part 2 of Schedule 15B, and the amount regarded as assessable profits are only determined in accordance with Schedule 15B. Subsection 7 prescribes that if a resident person is liable to tax in respect to the profits on an OFC by the operation of subsection 1 or 3 by reason of the person's having an indirect beneficial interest in the company through an interposed person or through a series of two or more interposed persons, then the resident person mentioned in paragraph A is discharged from the person's liability to tax in respect of the profit tax. If the resident person is not a resident person in Hong Kong, you would lose the link. If the interposed person is a non-resident, you cannot assess their taxes. So is the link broken, so to speak? Then your provision would be deemed useless. Deputy Commissioner, I would try to explain this provision. The assessable profits of a Hong Kong tax resident would be multiplied by a certain percentage. So the first question we ask is whether the assessable profits would exceed 30%. If so, you must pay taxes. The interposed person might be paying taxes, so the resident person of a highest level would not be subject to taxes again. Ms. Chang, Section 20AL. These stipulate the losses incurred in OFCs and whether they could be used to offset against any assessable profits. And 20AL also applies to sub-funds. The losses incurred by an OFC can only be set off against any assessable profits of the company in the year of assessment. The assessable profits from the non-qualified transactions can only be used to exempt the tax of that part. If an OSC is tax exempt, if the company sustain any losses from a non-Schedule 16A transaction, it cannot be used to offset against any assessable profits of the year because they already enjoyed a tax exemption. Since OFCs are only required to pay taxes for their directly operated businesses and investment in certain private companies, so there must be amendments to the title of Section 20AL. If an OFC is not exempt from the payment of tax, in other words, they do not enjoy tax exemption, similar amendments as subsection 1 are needed. For subsection 3, if an OFC suffers losses from a non-Schedule 16A transaction in a year of assessment, it can only be set off against any assessable profits of the company in the year of assessment or any subsequent year. For amendments to subsections 1 to 3, subsection 4 could be deleted because it's no longer needed. Section 5 adds a new Schedule 15B to deal with the and these are to provide for ascertaining amount of assessable profits of resident person under Section 20AK. Part 1 is the calculation of taxes. Part 2, the calculation of direct or indirect benefits. The provisions are same as the deeming provisions for offshore funds. Please continue. Section or clause 6 of the bill, the new 16A and 16B are added. And Schedule 16A is on the classes of assets specified for purposes of Section 20AH. For example, the asset classes OFCs can invest in to enjoy tax exemption. Since the 10% de minimis rule is removed, Schedule 16A serves to calculate the associated transactions under Section 20AH, and the businesses which would not enjoy exemptions. So for asset classes in Schedule 16, there are 8 asset classes in total. Please talk about your CSAs for Schedule 16A. We will move an amendment. According to the latest arrangement, if an OFC invests in a private company, whether local or overseas, the tax arrangements would be same. Under the current Schedule 16A, we are adopting the definitions under the Securities and Futures Ordinance, and the definitions do not include locally set up private companies, so we have to add local private companies to complete the picture. For shares or debentures issued by private companies, in the 2005 offshore fund exemption, did we update the schedule, or do you have no plans to update the permissible investments? Ms. Chang? That involved the tax arrangements for offshore funds. The arrangements would be reviewed, so the work is yet to be done. It is outside of the ambit of the bill. If you say that you would see ring fencing here, the offshore funds might also be subject to ring fencing. A lot of fund managers are complaining already. Please move on. The new Schedule 16B and it lists out the requirements for the NCH condition for OSCs, and we have talked about this in Section 20AI. So that's all for the bill. Thank you very much, Ms. Chang. Any questions from members? If not, have we missed anything for the CSAs? Legal advisor. The legal advisor has some questions. For 20AH, 4A and 4B, the English version is fine. For the Chinese text, 4A has defined the related companies. For 4A, again, the relevant companies are mentioned, so there is some ambiguity, and this does not tally with the English version. So I'd like to call your attention to that. Under 4A, does the company refer to the company in 4A? Department of Justice, thank you very much. The insertion of the term company in the Chinese version aims to facilitate the text. And in the English text, no short form is required, so the term does not arise in the English version, but there would not be any discrepancy in meaning. For capital A and capital B, the term related company in the Chinese version is once again repeated, so would amendments be needed? In 4A and 4B, the short form is the same, but the meanings are different. In 4BA, the company refers to a private company. And with the exception of private companies that hold immovable property, it's only a short form. This is different from the related company mentioned in 4 capital A. So do you mean that the term related company in 4 capital A and 4 capital B are different? Yes, they refer to different companies. Any other questions? Legal advisor, do you have other questions? If not, I have no further questions either. I'd like to remind members of the legislative timetable. If the bill is to receive resumption of second reading at the Council on the 21st of March, we must submit a report to the House Committee by the 23rd of February. Is this possible? Would an oral report be acceptable? Yes, that would be acceptable. If we submit an oral report to the House Committee on the 23rd of February, the deadline for moving amendments would be the 12th of March 2018, and the serving of notice for the resumption of second reading will be the 6th of March 2018. So this is based on the resumption of the second reading of the bill at the Council on the 21st of March.
Of course, there are other dates available. Perhaps the administration can work it out with the secretariat. I also hope that the resumption of the second reading of the bill can take place on the 21st of March, because we have many bills waiting to be scrutinized. So I thank the administration and members once again, and also the secretariat. Thank you.